to go do cardio every day. Well, nobody has time for that. I don't do an hour of cardio. I have never done an hour of cardio in the past 5-10 years.
Hi, everyone. Sorry. Studying for my doctoral class. Sorry about that. My name is John Joseph Andrew Alvarez Turner, Gasparini, Padilla, Flores, Martinez, Cardona, Fitzpatrick, Fernandez, Nieves, y Francesi. A lot of last names. Welcome to the MSP lecture series. I'm the Assistant Director for Multicultural Services and Programs here at the University of Georgia, Division of Student Affairs. Welcome to my humble abode here at the Intersection Space here in the Tate Student Center. I want to welcome you all to my presentation tonight, Hispanics and Latinos, We Don't All Eat Tacos. So to begin, I want to talk to you about the learning objectives with respect to this presentation. So by the completion of this presentation, the participants are going to identify the basic concepts of the Latino culture and understand the current demographics that exist here nationwide, and understand the complexities within the Latino-Hispanic population. Now, I'm going to warn you with respect to this presentation, if I do a full presentation that includes everything and everyone, this is gonna take 3 days. I only have 30 minutes, so I'm gonna be kind of cutting it a bit. And so if I miss your country, please don't be offended. Just know that you have an opportunity to ask questions beyond my presentation at the end of this lecture. So why this presentation? So there's a misconception about Latinos, Latinx being monolithic because of the language. Because we all speak Spanish, we all have to be the same. That is a misconception. There are many different cultures or subcultures within the Latinx community. So what's important for also to understand is for non-Latinx people to understand a little bit more about us because of those misconceptions, and also my personal experience. I don't know how many times I have gone out and people assumed that because I'm Hispanic that I am either Mexican or I am Spaniard or from some other country. And so we want to talk more about that, because for some people that can become very offensive. And finally, I want to tell a little story about cuisine confusion. And it literally has happened to many of my colleagues or friends of mine that have gone to or lived in areas where there is not a predominance of Latinos. So one time I actually was taken out by a few friends of mine to a Mexican restaurant. And we were all having Mexican food, and at the end of the meal, my friends asked me, "So, John, is this authentic?" And I'm like, "What do you mean? What are you talking about? Is the food authentic? Is it Mexican authentic?" And I was like, "Well, how would I know? I'm Puerto Rican." And the aha moment for them happened then, and I had to explain to them that the cuisine that comes from Mexico, although absolutely delicious, is not the cuisine that we have in Puerto Rico, where I am from. Therefore, I'm not an expert to determine whether something from Mexico, food from Mexico, was authentic or not, which was kind of laughed about it, but it gave me an aha moment to create a presentation like this for those who don't know about Latinos and the subcultures that fall underneath that. So let's talk a little bit about how diverse and ethnic our backgrounds are. We have many, many different types of Latinos, but we also have different ethnic groups as well as races. So I have on the screen William Levy, very popular telenovela actor. He is a white Cuban. He is an example of a white person, Caucasian person within the Latinx race. We also have Eva Mendes. Eva Mendes is another popular actress, and she is actually Amerindian. We have mestizos and Amerindian. These are people that have indigenous blood within them, and mixed with Caucasian, mixed with African, or just plain 100% indigenous people. So she's actually mixed with that race. We also have the Afro-Latino. And an example of that is Amari, who is also another actor that I pull up. And so we have the Afro-Latinx race that exists within the Hispanic Latinx community. And they and all of them together bring a plethora of culture and ethnicity within the greater culture of the Latino population. So let's talk a little bit about kind of like the boring stuff, kind of the census numbers, and we're gonna do some comparisons about that. So Latinos in, the Latino population in 2010 was about 53 million people. And that was around 17% of the overall population in the United States. And the overwhelming majority, I would say probably around 76% of the Hispanic population in the United States was Mexican, Puerto Rican, and Cuban. And so other populations are about 24%. So Hispanics are now literally, well, in 2010, became the largest minority in the United States. Now, push over to 2020, and we haven't completed the census, so the numbers actually come from 2018, and the population has reached all the way to 61 million. And so basically that what is really interesting about that is the fact that 52% of the nation's population growth were the Hispanic population. And between 2010 and 2019, we still are the largest minority in the United States. Now, the population is very diverse, and they trace their Latino heritage from South countries in Latin America as well as Spain, but the Mexican population within the United States is still the largest subpopulation of Latinos here. So more on the census data, and what you see here basically are the numbers from 2017, because once again, we haven't received the numbers yet from the 2020 census, and it shows that the biggest population, again, is the Mexican population at around the mid-30s, around 35 to 36 million people of Mexican descent or Mexican. And the next population are there, as you can see, is much much smaller, but it's the Puerto Rican population at 5 million. So here are the flags, and what I found interesting about the flags is being a language that's spoken quite a bit here in the Western Hemisphere, there are only 21 countries that actually speak Spanish, or Spanish is the main language spoken in that country. What a lot of people don't know is that people usually think that Spanish is only spoken in South America or the population, Central America, or the population you see in the United States. But there is actually an African country where their official language is Spanish, and that is Equatorial Guinea. Equatorial Guinea is on the western part of Africa, and that is their primary language. Spain, of course, is where the mother tongue is from, and we're going to discuss a little bit later about some of the dialects that make the Hispanic population different, because we speak different dialects of Spanish. So let's talk about music. It's my favorite genre besides food, and food is coming next, and I didn't forget food, but music was one of my favorite genres because it is so rich, culturally rich for our population, but at the same time, a little different. So I want to talk about bomba, which is bomba y plena, which is a not only a dance style, but also a music that comes out of my home country of Puerto Rico. So bomba is from Puerto Rico, and it is the first native music of the island, created in the sugar plantations by African slaves over 400 years ago. There are four instruments that are involved within this, and that is a cua, the maracas, and then there's also two drums that are part of that. What's really neat about the bomba is the fact that the dancers are pretty much acting out what is being sung, and they're acting it out to the drums. It is telling the story of the dancer and also the singer to the drums. So what's really neat is I'm gonna showcase a video right now of what bomba is like. It's gonna be about a minute and 30 seconds, and this is bomba from my island of Puerto Rico. So I hope that you really enjoyed that. I know that I get very nostalgic when I listen to that music because it is music that I grew up on, and we really bring it back, especially during Christmas time, because we love to play that music. And so the next kind of dance and music genre that I want to talk about is cumbia. Cumbia is from Colombia. Now, I'll have to tell you that I only recently learned about cumbia because what I really listen to in my home is merengue, salsa, bomba, things like that come from the Caribbean where I live. Now, one of the other music genres is cumbia from Colombia, and cumbia is also a folkloric dance and music that comes from and originated in Colombia, particularly in the Caribbean regions of Colombia, but has spread all over Latin America and Mexico. And what is really neat is that it's also influenced with African, but also Spanish and Native American cultural music. And there are many different styles of cumbia depending on what region that you are in. So traditionally, the instruments that are used are drums, flutes, other wind instruments. There's the accordion, a guitar, and other percussion instruments as well. But it has graduated as it modernized into brass instruments, where a more modern cumbia is played on the radios or in videos. Cumbia is really neat, and I'm going to give you an opportunity now to listen to what cumbia music sounds like. I'll give you about a minute to listen to this music so you can see how we start with the bomba, which is very, very African. It's as close as you can get to Africa and the Caribbean, and how it graduates and it gets more modernized with more modern brass instruments and things like that. So here's cumbia.
Tambores, estaré
hope you enjoyed that. I know that I did. It's new music that I've never heard before, and so now I'm playing it. I've put it in my iPhone so I can listen to it every so often while I'm studying. It's great music. So the next music that I and a genre that I want to talk about is tango. Tango from Argentina. Tango is a very sensual dance with this very sensual music. And what I wanted you to know about tango is that it originated in the suburbs of Argentina in the 19th century. This music literally is still played and done the same way as it was done in the 19th century, where you still see people in restaurants in the suburbs dancing in the middle of the street or in the middle of the restaurant while people are eating. It is a great cultural piece of music and dance that is still seen quite a bit, but also you see it in dance competitions. The nice thing about tango is that there are two main components, of course, is the dance and the music. But what's neat is that there are at least 9 different styles of tango, from the salon tango, which is really done in the dance halls, all the way to the more popularized Nuevo Tango, which you see today in the 1990s, and you can see a lot in the dance competitions that you see on TV. Now, I'm going to give you the opportunity to see and listen to the sensuality of tango from Argentina in this next video for about a minute, and I hope you enjoy it as much as I do. Enjoyed that video also. Like I said, I love tango. My uncle by marriage is Argentine, so when he was around, we always listened to it, as well as his classical guitarist. He was great at that, and so I hope that you enjoyed that. Just a little pause on the presentation. I want to let you know at this point, if you have any questions about anything that I'll be discussing tonight, please don't hesitate to go on the YouTube Live and put down your question so that I can answer it at the end of my presentation. All is fair game, so please do not hesitate to ask those questions. So going back to the musical and dance genre, many of you know that there are different types of music. I have 3 more that are up on my presentation, but I want to also remind of one that I forgot to put on my presentation, and that is reggaeton. Everybody knows what reggaeton is, and that is a classic example of merging different types of musical styles and borrowing musical styles from jazz to R&B, coming together and forming a type of music that is extremely popular all over Latin America. It's been heard even in Europe and particularly here in the United States. But music that you'll know that exists here that comes from the island, one of them is salsa. Salsa is a Cuban and Puerto Rican melding together of Afro-Cuban rumba, which is another style of music and dance, as well as Puerto Rican bomba. Another one is merengue. And again, merengue comes from the Dominican Republic. Again, it's a different musical style that comes from that island. And it was actually seen and created around the mid-19th century as well. And And that is rhythm and music that really has been known to be heard in the regions of the Congo and has been brought over to the island, and it became what it is in the mid-19th century. I also want to include my brothers and sisters from Brazil. They create the most incredible sensual music, and one of them is samba. Samba comes from Brazil, and it is a genre of dance and music that comes from Central Africa and Europe, and the music is very popular with the population of Brazil, and it has become their national identity. And as a matter of fact, you can listen to a lot of samba in within Carnival, which you see right before Easter. So let's talk about my favorite thing to do every day, and that's eating. La comida, the cuisine. Now, the food is probably one of the most, is the identity of some of these countries and the population of Latinos, and it is very distinct, and there are many different influences to the food that we eat in Latin America and the Caribbean. So I want to discuss a little bit about that. The first thing that I want to talk about is Dominican, Cuban, and Puerto Rican cuisines. My goodness, there's not a day that goes by that I wish that I were back home in Florida just to smell the different restaurants that create these wonderful cuisines of Caribbean cuisine coming from Cuba, Puerto Rico, and the Dominican Republic. They have a slight difference. They're not the same. They have a slight difference. What is similar about them is that they have a deep connection with Africa, West Africa in particular, as well as Spain and the indigenous people that live in the Caribbean, which are the Arawak Taino Indians. And so the food is very savory. There is a misconception that all Latin food is spicy because they think Mexican. It isn't for the Caribbean. There are some foods that require a little bit of spiciness to it, but for the most part, the food is not spicy, but it is very, very savory and very, very well seasoned. The pictures that you see within this slide is food that you see typically coming from this region. The first picture on the top left is a carne guisa. It is kind of a stewed meat with yellow rice and peas. Immediately to the right, you see the national dish of Puerto Rico, which is yellow rice and pigeon peas, or what we call in Spanish, arroz con gandules. You see that in many, many major celebratory events for the Puerto Rican population, especially during Christmas time. And if you want to know what we have for Thanksgiving, we adopted, yes, turkey for Thanksgiving, but always a side dish of arroz con gandules need to be included. On the bottom left, you will see a particular dish that you see in Cuba, and that is congri, which is a black bean and dirty rice. It is absolutely delicious. You see some yuca in there, which is a taro root type of food. It is absolutely delicious. And finally, on the bottom right, on the bottom right, you'll notice another picture. Puerto Rico is a very seafood-eating island, and so that food right there that you see is just a stew of the different kinds of seafood that you find on our island. It's called asopao de marisco. So let's talk about Mexican cuisine. We cannot get away discussing Latino or Latinx cuisine if we don't talk about Mexican cuisine. So Mexican cuisine is one of the oldest cuisines that you see in the world. Mexican cuisine goes back 9 millennia. That is 9,000 years. Back to the Olmec and the Mayan, all the way to the Aztecs. The style of food is particularly a fusion with the indigenous population that I just named, and then later on it melded with the European population that came to Mexico, particularly the Spaniards. Some things that that are included is that is the food is very savory, depending on the region within Mexico, because even the regions have different types of cuisine. And so depending on the region is the kind of savoriness that you get in the food. And some of the food can be very, very spicy, depending on the chilies that are used. It consists of spices that are found in different parts of Mexico, but the cuisine has become so popular that you see it being cooked everywhere in Latin America. No, Taco Bell is not authentic. And a lot of people get that perception. You have to go to an authentic Mexican restaurant to get the real stuff. And there is, once again, there is a difference based on the region of the type of Mexican cuisine that you're gonna get. And so the final country that I want to talk about today is a little Central American country, and it's a beautiful country called El Salvador. And what I love about El Salvador is the type of cuisine that they have, and it's more indigenous in nature. It consists of food from different parts of the peoples that you see there that include I can't pronounce the name of some of the Native Americans, and I don't want to kill it, but they're more Mayan-based populations. And so this food is absolutely delicious. And what you see, one of the foods that you see that are pictured on there is one of my favorites, and I just recently had some, and it's addicting. They're called pupusas. I love them because they stuff them with different things, from cheese to meats. Absolutely delicious, but the content of the food is maize-based, maize being corn. Another type of food that I put on there, and it's on the bottom right, is sopa de pata, which is really the innards of a cow, like tripe. Absolutely delicious. I actually tried this meal when I lived in Akron, Ohio, and it's very hearty and it's very delicious. So now I want to talk about something that's tremendously important for us, and that is our language. Our language is everything to us. It is the key to what makes us the Latinidad of our cultures. And so I want to talk a little bit about the language. And so with that, I'm going to start with a video. You guys will recognize this comedian, and we'll talk about that afterwards.
Standing, huh? No pressure. Mm-hmm. We're having fun, you guys. We are here coming to you from South Florida. Heck yeah, man. Really close. I gotta ask a question since we're here. I just want to know, how many Latinos in the crowd tonight? Now, notice I asked Latinos. I wasn't very specific. Because if you call a Latino the wrong one, there's an issue. You call a Mexican, a Salvadorian, we get mad. You call a Puerto Rican, a Dominican, they get mad. You call a Cuban, anything but a Cuban, you're going to get stabbed. So for everyone here and everyone at home, I have found a way to figure out who's who. It's very easy. All you have to do is listen to the way the person is speaking Spanish. You don't have to understand a single word, just listen to the flow. That'll let you know. For example, Mexicans, when we speak Spanish, we sound high. Seriously, you ask us a question, we drag it out. Hey, bro, how's it going?
Pues aquí nomás, hombre. Pues tú sabes, güey.
Now, Cubans, I found out Cubans, you guys speak Spanish like everything means something. It's very serious. You ask a Cuban a question, bro, where you going?
Al baño, coño, carajo. What you want to know?
Just asking, dude. It's like, why is he yelling? I don't know. And I found out Puerto Ricans, you guys speak Spanish like there's a time limit. Ask a question, hey, bro, what's up? Mira, mi bro, el otro día estaba cogiendo, me estaba platicando que chacha bendito, yo no sé lo que estaba pasando aquí, no más por ahí. Dame más gasolina. Just fast. Even Mexicans were like, hey, write that down. Quick, another way, is the beverage. The beverage will let you know who you're dealing with. For example, a Mexican's preferred drink of choice is tequila, okay? A Puerto Rican's preferred drink of choice is either Don Q or Coquito, right? And a Cuban's preferred drink of choice is coffee. Now, let me tell you how I know about this one. So a few years ago, Martina and I were doing a show at the Improv in Miami, and after the show was over, I was talking to Martina. I said, hey, bro, I said, we got to try out some of this Cuban food everybody's been talking about. It's our first time here. And so we go outside to catch a cab, and when we got in the car, I figured something out, and that is that Cubans come in every color of the rainbow. Cubans and Puerto Ricans, you go from really, really white all the way to freaking navy black, just hardcore. Wesley Snipes, just dark, scudo.
El negro!
Hardcore, you know what I mean? I didn't know that there was such a thing as a black Cuban, because we get in the car and we're speaking Spanish, and this guy turns around and he's black and he's like, ¿Dónde quieren ir? ¿Where you wanna go? I'm like, oh my God! It freaked me out. I thought the partition was tinted. I didn't know. So he's yelling at us, ¿Dónde quieren ir? I'm like, dude. Why is he yelling? I said, listen, we want to go somewhere to get some authentic Cuban food. Where can we go? And then he takes us to this place called Calle Ocho, which for everyone at home, Calle Ocho is Spanish for 8th Street, and it's an area where, you know, it's very authentic. And he takes us to this restaurant called La Carreta, okay? So you can't miss it. There's a restaurant on the corner with a giant wagon wheel in front of it and a huge rooster. I don't know what the rooster does, but look out for him. We walk inside, and I think, what was it, Martin? Like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning when we went in?
Easy 3 in the morning.
Easy 3 o'clock in the morning. We sit down at this table, and we're looking at the menu. We're trying to figure it out, and there's all kinds of bananas and all kinds of weird stuff. That I'm like, I didn't know that, sir. Okay, bananas, fine. Okay, let's do this. And here comes the waiter, and the waiter's coming over, and he gets in my face, and he's like, ¿Qué tú quieres? And I'm like, I forgot. Why is he yelling? I don't know. I said, listen, bro, I'll tell you what. Let me look at this menu a little bit longer. I think we need some time, right, Mark? Yeah, we were like, yeah, we need some more time. And I says, for right now, can I just get a coffee? And he's like, okay, un cafecito. And he walks into the kitchen. He comes back 5 minutes later, seriously, with a little coaster and a shot glass of coffee on the coaster. And he puts it down in front of me, and he's like, okay. And I'm like, what is this? Es un cafecito. I go, dude, look at me. I'm not a Ito. I'm a Ande. And then I started thinking, maybe he knows who I am. I get the joke. Bring the really big guy, the really little cup. You know what I mean? And I said, bro, what is it? I go, no. I'll bring me a full-size cup of coffee. Take this back. I was frustrated. So the guy's like, okay. And what you want? Okay. So he grabs it all pissed off. And then he goes in the kitchen and he starts talking trash to one of the cooks. He's like, Manolo. And then he comes back with a bowl of Cuban coffee, okay? And he puts it down in front of me and he won't leave the table. He's like, okay. And I'm like, okay. 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 Oh, I get it. He wants me to make sure this is what I want, you know, what I want, right? So I pick up the bowl and I take a little sip of it. And when the coffee hit my tongue, I was like, oh my God, this is the most concentrated coffee I've ever had. It was really, really strong. And then it clicked. That's why they bring you a little shot glass of this stuff. So now I don't want to look stupid making him take a bowl of coffee back in the kitchen. So I picked it up to my face again and I drank the whole thing. Well done. I knew I messed up, bro. I knew I messed up because a waiter looked at me and he's like, vaya con Dios. He goes back in the kitchen. He's like, Manolo, call 911. 10 minutes go by, you guys. I am so wired. That coffee is strong. That is the only way in the world Cubans can make that swim.
Y'all, I hope that you enjoyed that, and hopefully one day MSP can partner up with University Union to bring him on to the University of Georgia campus. It would be fantastic to have such a great comedian here. But going back to the different Spanish dialects that I like to talk about, we want to first start with the language where the mother tongue came from, and that is Spain. the peninsulares, the Spanish, what we call peninsulares, and that is Castilian Spanish. This is the Spanish that is spoken, and it's the official language, particularly spoken in central Spain. You can hear this, you can go to any YouTube video coming out of Madrid, and you'll hear him speak that type of Castilian Spanish. The other one comes from the southern part of Spain, and that is Andalusian Spanish, and that Spanish, again, is a little bit different than what is spoken, and the way they speak it, you can tell, and I wish I had time to give you a video so you can see the difference, but there is a difference, as well as Murcian Spanish, which is spoken in the southeast part. There are many other dialects that are spoken in Spain that are not particularly Spanish, like Catalan is one of them, but there are many different dialects, and it starts from the Iberian Peninsula. Now, the next one I want to talk about is the Canary Islands, and that is Canarian Spanish. This Spanish is closely resembles to the Spanish that you listen to in the Caribbean Spanish dialects, and the vocabulary is heavily influenced not just by the African tongues, particularly from West Africa, but also a Portuguese kind of melding within the language because of the Portuguese influence. The next dialect I want to talk about is called Janito. Now, Janito comes from the Gibraltar region. If you didn't already know, Gibraltar is a British area that is controlled by Great Britain within the Iberian Peninsula. Now, this Spanish is a combination of a Spanish that is spoken on the mainland in Spain, but also mixed with English. So it's kind of like Puerto Ricans speak Spanglish. It's kind of like a fancy version of Spanglish. So let's talk about the country that we talked about earlier on in the presentation, and that is the Equatorial Guinea Spanish. And that Spanish is a melding of the African tongue that is spoken in Equatorial Guinea with some German influence that comes out of Cameroon. I don't know about you, but when I listen to Equatorial Guinea, they really sound like just another Puerto Rican talking it, but in Africa. So let's talk about Latin American Spanish, and I think this is the Spanish in the Americas, and I had to kind of keep it on a continental level versus a region, because there are many different dialects that are spoken from Colombia to Peru to Bolivia, and you already heard Gabriel Iglesias talking about the different dialects. Well, it's even worse. Within the country, you can have different dialects of Spanish spoken. What's spoken in Colombia from the urban areas of Colombia is different than when you hear the costeños talking on the coastal regions of Colombia. So Latin American Spanish varies within the country about where you're at. Let's talk a little bit about Caribbean Spanish. Caribbean Spanish includes Cuba, Puerto Rico, and Dominican Republic, but also can include areas of northern Venezuela, the coasts of Mexico that surround the Gulf of Mexico that have an African influence. And so the Spanish spoken in this region have a lot of African influences. For instance, some of the words that are said to describe certain things, for instance, banana. Banana, the way we say it in Spanish, is guineo, whereas the rest of the Hispanic world is called plátano. And so the guineo is a Western African influence within our vocabulary. It is a neat spoken Spanish, and if you go to Puerto Rico, we even meld American English. We are that nimble with the languages. And this is the end of my presentation tonight, and so at this point, I'm going to take any questions that you all might have regarding the presentation or anything that has to do with the Latina, Latinx world, Hispanic world. Anything is fair play. I didn't speak about religion. Religion is very diverse, so if you have any questions about religion, don't hesitate to ask. And now I have my trusty MSP staff behind me that's going to feed me some of the questions little by little. So they're coming up to let me know some of the questions, and I'm going to be I'm going to be answering them as I get them. So the first question is a real neat one. What effect do you think the growing population of Hispanic individuals will have on government? And that is a neat question. One of the things that there is a misconception about is that politically the Hispanic and Latinx population are monolithic. They are not. There are many different, depending on the experiences of the population, of the individual populations coming to the United States, they have their political beliefs aligned with that, whether it's Republican, Democrat, or independent. There is an influence. If you go down to Miami, where I used to live, or Orlando, where I used to live, they have a heavily influenced Hispanic population that do things that also help the Hispanic population there. For instance, in Orange County, Florida, where I lived, in Orlando, there is a heavy Puerto Rican population that actually makes themselves very well known in Central Florida. Whereas if you go to the Miami-Dade area, you see influences particularly from the Cuban community as well as the other communities that come in, for instance, Argentine, Nicaraguans, and Venezuelans, as well as others. So there is a heavy influence. You go to Texas, there is more of a Chicano-Mexican, as well as California, very Chicano-Mexican influence within the government. I will also say, if you look at some of the names of our states, they have Hispanic names. The most notable is Florida, Texas, Montana. Montana means mountain. Florida means flowers. And Texas is just a name that came from Mexico. Tejas is the correct way of saying it for us anyways in Spanish. Okay, so let's go to the next question. And what role does language play in identifying with Latinx and Hispanic culture? Language is everything for us, especially for us first generation. It is what keeps us tied like an umbilical cord from the mother country that we came from. Spanish from Puerto Rico, the not just the language but also the cultural aspects, is what keeps me. It makes me happy just thinking about it. And every so often, I want to listen to Spanish be spoken. I go back home. I go to Florida or I go to visit Puerto Rico, and I feel like I'm alive again. When the island of Puerto Rico calls me and she calls me, I go back because I need that to re-energize myself. So language plays a distinct role in the Latinx and Hispanic culture, especially when it comes to music, our food, and just the way we party. So that's a great question. I hope I was able to answer it. So the next question is, do you think the lines distinguishing the cultural dishes are getting blurrier? Yes. And I'll be straight up with that. Some of the things that I find most offensive is when people assume that when they go to one of these chain restaurants to eat Latin melded food, that it's authentic. It isn't. And one of the things that I would encourage you to do is that if you can't go to one of these foreign Latin countries in South America or Spain or you know anywhere that is not part of the United States, if you can't go to those, I really highly recommend for you to go to Puerto Rico. You don't need a passport to go there. And one of the things that I would ask you to do is try the street foods in Puerto Rico. When you eat the street foods from Puerto Rico, you are getting the genuineness of our island. You are getting the heart of our island because cuisine is everything for us. It is what makes us culturally rich because of its mixture with the African and the indigenous Taino Arawak Indians of our island, as well as our Spanish ancestors. That's a great question. So question number four, are you confident, comfortable in the number of authentic restaurants as an option when dining out? No, I'm not. Before I go to a restaurant that claims to be authentic and I want to take friends with me who don't know the cuisine, I make sure I try the food first to know that's authentic. If I'm taking them to a Puerto Rican restaurant, I've become well versed with some of the Mexican authentic food because I had a lot of Mexican friends when I lived in Akron, Ohio, that took me to the places where authentic Mexican food was created to determine if the food is authentic or not. I'm still not an expert, but I can tell very much immediately. Once again, my friends, Taco Bell is not authentic Mexican. That is purely an American creation. That's a great question. And no, in many instances, I'm not comfortable. And when I'm not, when I take my partner or my partner's family who are of German descent, I let them know fairly immediately when I taste the food, this is not authentic. So the next question, do you believe the growing Latinx population in America will allow for an increase in authentic representation? As long as we keep the traditions alive, brought forth by first generations who move here, I think that's tremendously important. I think one of the things that my mom and my dad decided to do is to make sure that Spanish was spoken in the household, but as well as keeping some of the traditions of music, of dance, of family celebrations, the thing that brings the Latinidad alive within us. Now, I'm not going to lie. There were times where when I went to college and I went to predominantly white institutions where I felt like I needed to hide that Latinidad because I felt the discomfort of not being accepted. And these are things that I had to work through until very recently where I literally, and it was actually a professor, Dr. Vasti Torres, who I spoke with, that I realized I really should be proud of the rich culture that I bring, and the best way to deal with ignorance regarding our culture is to teach about it. And so I feel like as long as we remember what our ancestors brought here to the United States and continue that tradition alive, absolutely, I think that we can keep our authentic representation. That's a great question. And so I believe that was the last question. We may have one more. Okay.
Any recommendation on how the UGA community could better serve and support Latinx communities?
So the question is, how can UGA best support the Latinx community here on campus? I think it's tremendously important that part of that is to bring cultural events on campus, and not just cultural events from one region, but cultural events from many regions that are represented here at UGA. And I think that's important because we need to learn about each other. Sometimes we need to learn within the Hispanic population about ourselves, but externally beyond our own Latino students on this campus, I think it's tremendously important that we teach, whether it's a cultural event, whether it's a comedy event. Once again, I recommend Gabriel Iglesias to bring on this campus. He'll be fantastic to talk about how culturally rich our population is. talk about our food, serve our food. I will tell you, when International Coffee Hour comes back full force, hopefully next year after this pandemic, I promise you one of the things that I will bring coming out of MSP is the great food that we serve from each of our countries. Recently, last year during the coffee hour that we had, I served Puerto Rican food because it was an islander theme. Hopefully, we can bring more of that for you all to understand, including some of the music that we will share. And maybe we can get some of our student organizations to teach the dances and things like that. So I think that also bringing in more students that are Latino on this campus to attend the University of Georgia will bring that cultural richness to this and add more salsa to this university. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I want to, if there's no other questions, I want to thank you all for participating in our lecture series. And on October the 7th, one of my biggest heroes here in the University of Georgia, Professor Dr. Delgado Romero, is going to be speaking also about the issues of Latinos that exist, students, and so forth. And I think it's really important that you listen to what he has to say October the 7th, around the same time. You're going to enjoy that lecture. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. You all have a fabulous evening. Adios.